Recording live from Glory Hole Studios in Chicago and beyond, this is Cognitive Dissonance. Every episode we blast anyone who gets in our way. We bring critical thinking, skepticism, and irreverence to any topic that makes the news, makes it big, or makes us mad. It's skeptical, it's political, and there is no welcome mat. This is episode 630. And Cecil, we are joined by a special guest. A kind of an inspiration.
Yeah, absolutely.
If we're being genuine.
Absolutely.
Right, which we sometimes are and mostly aren't. But today, we are. And really an inspiration. We are joined by Dr. Stephen Novella, Skeptics Guide to the Universe. Dr. Novella, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you, guys. It's a pleasure to be here.
What we want to start to talk a little bit about this brand new book. Can you tell us like why your team decided to put this book together?
Talking about the second book now, The Skeptic's Guide to the Future.
Yeah, the future, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that one, yeah, that's coming out September 27th. You can pre-order it now, but it hasn't fully come out. So, you know, we're techno nerds. We love science fiction, love thinking about the future. This has been a lifelong fascination of ours, especially, Bob, Jay, and I. So, we definitely want to continue writing books. We have a lot of ideas about like what the next book in the lineup would be. And, I came up with the idea for this book and I knew that this had to be our next book. It was a no-brainer. I pitched it to Bob and Jay. They're like, yeah, absolutely. This would be, it was a ton of fun to write, a ton of fun to research, just whenever we would get together to talk about the chapters in the book. It was just, we had so much fun writing it. We hope that, it's the same experience when people read it. But, generally speaking, people have done a horrible job of predicting the future. And so we said, there's a lot of room here for us to take a skeptical approach to futurism, just thinking about futurism itself. And then we'll see, maybe we could do a little bit better. So we'll put our nickel down and try to, predict the future as well and see how it goes. So,
how much psychic power do you plan to use every year?
Every year we see the psychic predictions.
Yeah, we used to do it. God, we've been doing this for a long time. Yeah. Cecil and I, for years, we would, at New Year's, we'd have an episode. I don't know if we did it last year.
Last year was a disaster.
Yeah, so it wasn't funny anymore.
Not funny anymore.
But for the longest time, for a decade plus, we'd be like, all right, let's look and see what they predicted last year. And then it was inevitably so wrong. So when you're thinking about futurism, why do you think it is that futurists, and outside of psychics, that's obviously nonsense, but futurists, why do you think they get it wrong so often?
So that's a big chunk of the book, is we talk about that exact question, and we actually outline what we call futurism fallacies, right? What are the common mistakes that futurists make? And then we, just by looking at the past attempts at projecting technology into the future, the farther back you go, the more laughable, the futurist predictions become. But the themes are still there. Like one, as an example, is taking some current trend and projecting it indefinitely into the future. As, cell phones are getting smaller, so they're going to continue to get smaller.
Right,
until they're teeny, tiny, teeny. Remember Minority Report, they had the really teeny cell phones.
Right, right.
It's like, yeah, but sometimes technology takes a left-hand turn. The way people use it changes and there's disruptive technologies and it's hard to predict how people are going to interact with technology. I think that's why. I mean, and when you think about it also, if you go back 100 years, the futurists of that time didn't have a lot of previous futurists to learn off of. So they were just winging it. They were just doing what made sense to them and not realizing that they were falling into all these pitfalls. But now we could look back and say, oh yeah, look at all, that there all these different ways in which the futurists fail. But we're not going to do that. We're going to learn those lessons and try to account for them. In all honesty, we do give glimpses of the future, which are more fun than anything else, but mainly we don't try to predict details that are unpredictable. It's like the difference between predicting the weather and predicting climate. Like you can't tell me if it's going to rain, you know, a year from now on a very specific day. That's like trying to predict a very specific future technology. But, you know, we do know that things are generally getting warmer. And so we can sort of predict these broad brushstrokes. And also we try to paint out possibilities. Like, these are the possible futures depending on these variables. So, you know, we are to hedge our bets a lot, but that's the only way you can reasonably extrapolate into the future by saying these are the possibilities depending on these variables. Yeah.
I mean, obviously the goal is to achieve full Jetsons. I think that is that's it, right?
Jetsons.
I mean,
we want the Jetsons is it.
Yeah. You got to have a robot made that balances on a single wheel.
Yes.
Zipping around.
Absolutely. A robot dog.
With a sassy attitude.
Yeah, absolutely. I think all of these things.
Because my Roomba has no attitude at all. Just absolutely
terrible.
Flat.
Terrible. Boring. Just literally boring. Unless you put googly eyes on a Roomba, which is amazing.
Which I have done.
Which is amazing.
I do have googly eyes on my Roomba. Still, second worst conversationalist in the house.
Yeah.
Just mediocre.
Can I ask? We want to talk about your current book that's currently out too, but I want to ask this question. When you look at the future, do you think you look at it half full or half empty? If we're talking about like glass half full.
Yeah. Is it so bright you have to wear shades or no?
So actually we give the full spectrum. We talk about, if everything works out perfectly well, this is the techno-utopia we will create for ourselves, or we could have the techno-apocalypse. You know, so with many of the technologies we talk about, we give a range of scenarios. So like nanotechnology could cure death, or it could turn the surface of the earth into 3 feet deep of paperclips. You know, one or the other, you know, either will completely destroy civilization or will cure all of our problems. Probably it's going to be somewhere in the middle. I mean, so realistically we say, yeah. So
a foot and a half of paper clips and we live 6 years longer. That's
the range of possibilities. And that's also one of the fallacies, you know, it's like you think in these black and white terms, like this technology is going to only be good or only be bad. And the vast majority of technologies, you know, cut both ways. They may be disruptive. They may have some downsides. They can be abused. They can, you know, like look at social media and the internet. It's been wonderful and horrible at the same time.
Yeah.
Right. And that's the way most big technologies are going to do that. They will give us great things and also completely screw with our society, you know?
So this is interesting. So I just finished reading, and I don't know that I recommend it. I read Homo Deus. Have you read Homo Deus? Kind of a bigger book out there.
It's
by the same guy who wrote Sapiens, kind of one of those bigger pop sci kind of books that's out there. And there's a lot of discussion. There's a lot of futurism in Homo Deus. It's very much a futurist kind of a book. And I think it's riddled with all kinds of these sort of absolutist flaws. So when I read it, I'm sort of dubious of a lot of these assertions. But one of the things I'm curious to get your take on is one of the discussions that's kind of been had again is about this idea of conquering death. And you just brought it up very briefly with respect to nanobots or nanotechnology, not necessarily nanobots. And I'm curious what your thought is on that in general, because I've always thought myself, like, it doesn't sound desirable, much less achievable. But I'm curious what your thoughts are on that sort of thing.
So we discussed that directly in the book. And it's like, all right, if our goal is to become immortal, what are the different pathways to that? Which again is another fallacy in that we think there's only one path to any outcome, when in fact there's often multiple different ways, you know, different technological pathways where we might get to an end. And they will probably exist side by side and complement each other, et cetera. So you think, you know, are we going to just get really better and better and better at like stem cell technology, where we could basically just infinitely regenerate our tissue? Or are we going to get, is it going to be more the nanotechnology pathway, where we are using, you know, hard machines to manipulate our biology? Or is it going to be genetic technology? Or are we going to say, just forget these meat suits, let's just, you know, somehow migrate our consciousness into silicon, into something, you know, into an artificially intelligent matrix, and then that will be the form of our immortality. The like for one of the problems is the brain, right? Because you are your brain, basically. Like you can't.
Yeah,
there is no like I'm going to upload my conscience. It doesn't exist. Like you are your brain. The firing of those neurons, that is you, and you can't move it anywhere or take it out or do transfer it or anything. That's why I had to be really careful. There are theoretical ways you might be able to slowly migrate it, you know, but that's we won't go down that rabbit hole just yet. So the ultimate limiting factor is going to be the longevity of your brain. Even if you can regrow your body every 20 years or 30 years, you can't regrow a new brain because then you won't be you, right? It'll just be some new person. You'll be a clone, right? It won't be you. So that's the ultimate limit. And there's really no way around that. You know, complicated systems are just not infinitely renewable like that, right? You just build up junk and mistakes and whatever. You might be able to prolong it for a really long time, but never forever, without literally undoing all the information. There's only one, animal that's immortal. It's like this jelly, but it actually like gives birth to itself. There's no neuronal continuity, from one generation to the next.
Right.
So it's not neurologically immortal. So the our brains are ultimately going to be the limiting factor on our immortality. So that's where it's like, that's it. Unless, of course, you accept some method of migrating to a machine. And then we have to have the discussion of continuity. And is that really you or not? And what are there any methods that are acceptable? But not going to happen anytime soon. That's for sure.
Yeah.
But I think we're going to be seeing some significant life extension in the next 100 years or so. But nothing approaching immortality.
And it's going to miss us.
One side for this. A lot of times when people ask if something's going to happen, what they're really asking is when is this going to happen?
Right.
Because if you go a million years in the future, whatever, depending on how far you want to go into the future, we can't really set limits on anything because there's a point beyond which we can't really even speculate anymore about what the technology is going to be like. Now we're just talking about physics, like just theoretically, what are the limits of physics, but not like the limits of technology. So when somebody says like, will we ever achieve this? Like, will we ever get to a fully general artificial intelligence? It's like, yeah, of course we will. The only really question is when, because it's not impossible. And if it's not impossible, at some point we'll figure out how to do it. But will it be 100 years, 1,000 years, a million years? I mean, that's the question, is how long is it going to take?
Yeah. It's funny. I think about that idea of this like infinite extension. And it's like, if we don't figure out like quality of life, I get out of bed too fast. My back hurts all day. If I feel a sneeze coming on, I'm 44. I got to feel a sneeze. I got to brace myself and make sure I don't throw my shit out. I can imagine a world, and I really can. I can imagine a world where we figure out an answer for most of the life-ending disease and degenerative processes. But it's still like, yeah, but you know what? You still have a vertical spine and a horizontally spined body. And so like, you're just like, yeah, okay, my God, I'm going to live forever. But like, I can't open a pickle jar without screaming. So why?
Well, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. You have to combine quality of life with duration. And again, that brings up another sort of way you're predicting the future can go awry. If you think about simplistically, like we're going to have one goal. Like the goal to live longer. It's like, yeah, but no, that's not how things are always interacting with each other. And the other thing is you say, you're trying to predict one technology. Like, okay, what if it takes us 300 years to get to the point where we could live for thousands of years? We won't even talk about infinite, just a really long time. Oh, it's going to suck because it will be frail and everything. It's like, yeah, but by the time, anytime you're predicting the impact of a future technology, you have to think simultaneously about how all the other technologies are going to have advanced in that same amount of time. So if it takes us a couple of hundred years to get there, we're also going to have 200 years of advancement in every other technology. Yeah. Yeah. And how will they be interacting with each other? So you can't just look at one technology and project it forward. It's always, how are all of these technologies going to be interacting with each other? So that, you know, again, it gives you a glimpse as to what the answer might be. It doesn't tell you because there's too many probabilities. You know, you're trying to predict the future of hundreds of technologies simultaneously. You can't do it. But you could think about, you know, you could think about how they might be interacting with each other.
Yeah. So, okay. So what about the public's idea of science in this sense, right? So we think about how sometimes the public, like right now, like doesn't think that maybe NASA funding is worthwhile or anything. That clearly slows down or speeds up whether or not how quickly we move forward, right? So do you talk about that at all?
Yeah. So when we're trying to predict like the 2050 year timeframe,
yeah,
that's where that's really important.
Sure.
You know, it's like, sure. And in fact, so let me back up a little bit. We look at the history of technology and, you know, Ford, for example, famously chose to market a gasoline engine, internal combustion engine, as the first real, you know, consumer automobile. And his plan was that the second one would be an electric vehicle. Now, what if he had reversed that order and did the electric one first? Would that have changed the next 100 years of technology of the automotive industry? And then it turned out he didn't mass produce the electric car because of patent rights over batteries and fighting over this and that. It was like all political stuff. It wasn't technology. It was political. But then there's also this from another angle. It's like, well, if we were a little bit ahead of the curve on the electrical grid, then electric cars may have just beat out the internal combustion engine. But because it was just easier, or if we discovered gasoline 10 years later, whatever, there's all these little variables. So, you know, as one point in the book, I say, so when you go back 100 or 200 years and try to pull those threads forward to today, you can't even predict today. Like you can't put yourself back 100 years and predict what today's technology would be like. So forget about going 100 years in the future. So in the short term, you know, the really short term, it is kind of easy because you're just extrapolating existing technology, that next step. But even if you go even as much as 50 years, it's all about the choices that we are making, both individually and collectively. And that's the one thing you can't predict is what choices are we going to make? You know, there are individual people like Elon Musk, for example, who has a tremendous amount of power to alter the course of future technology with quirky individual decisions.
Right.
And so that 50-year, you know, realm, it just becomes really hard to predict for that reason. And so we have to say things like, if we choose to push this technology forward, this is where it could go. You know, the one thing that I've been fascinated by for 20 years is this, the coming hydrogen economy. Now, you guys are old enough to know that we've been talking about, how long have we been talking about the coming hydrogen economy?
Right.
Why don't we have it? Why don't we have it? And there's political reasons and there's technological reasons and there's quirky reasons, you know, but in 50 years, are we going to have it? What would need to happen for that to be the case? And it's not just what would need to happen with hydrogen technology, but all the competing technologies.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it gets better. If battery technology kicks its ass, it's why would we double down on hydrogen? And so you always have to talk about if then, like if we decide to go this route, this is the potential of where it could lead, but we have to, you know, think about all these other things, you know, that would be competing with it, or maybe people won't like it. That's the other thing. Like the Segway was great technology.
Yeah.
Right. Fantastic. The technology it worked. That's again another fallacy. Like if the technology works, people will use it. It's like no, not necessarily. People might decide like on silly things. Like it looks dorky. I'm not going to use that technology because it looks dorky. And then
electric
it
cars
dies on the vine. Or
our current electric car system owes that to Tesla in some ways, right? I mean, like
they made a car that didn't look stupid.
He made a car that looks good and people want to own something. Yeah, it looks sharp.
Looks futuristic. I love it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, absolutely. There's a lot of this marketing is involved, you know, absolutely. You could really only talk about, again, like the potential and and try to, you know, imagine how things might play out. But there's just so many individual variables there.
It's funny, like on just kind of a tangential note, I do a lot of hiring. So I look at like different interview questions and try to do a better job doing that time to time. I usually don't succeed. But one of the sort of classic questions that I don't ask, but I have thought about, and everybody's heard it, is like, where do you see yourself in 5 years? And everybody's heard that question. I think it's an asinine question. But it is kind of funny to think back, and I've used this as a thought experiment personally many times, and thought, if I were to go back and say, 5 years, just 5 years, and say, okay, predict out the next 5 years, I would have gotten everything wrong.
Sure.
Like if I were to go back in time to 2017, and in just 5 years, and say, predict the world in 2022, I would have got, I can tell you with certainty that every reasonably important thing, I would not have predicted the pandemic and any of the migration and social changes that came with that. I would not have predicted, you know, the war in Russia with Ukraine, although maybe I should have. There's so many things I would get wrong just at a very basic macro level on a 5-year time scale. And then like, it's also a fun game to play with your personal life, because it's also always been wrong for me too. But it's kind of funny that 5 years is an impossibility to get right in most meaningful ways. So futurism has a high bar to cross.
Absolutely. But a couple of thoughts on that. One is, you know, past, future, all futurists, you know, when you're predicting the future, you're also creating a time capsule, right? So you're essentially describing your current time, and when you predict the future, you're really reflecting the thoughts and ideas and biases and perspective of the day. Oh, it really says more about your time than actually the future. So you do create a time capsule, and then it's fun to go back and say, what did the people from 50 years ago predict about the future? And that gives you this window into that time period.
Right.
So
it offers historical perspective.
So we hope that our own book will be a fascinating document for future futurists. But when you talk about something like the pandemic, interestingly, you know, like we interviewed an infectious disease specialist on our show, Mark Clissup, about 15 years ago, and he completely nailed it. He predicted the pandemic to a T. Now, we didn't say it was going to be specifically a coronavirus, and he didn't say it was going to be like 2020 to 2022 or whatever. He didn't, but he said, yeah, sometime in the next 10 to 20 years, there's going to be a major respiratory pandemic. And he said, stock up on toilet paper. It's going to disrupt, you know, the economy. People are going to have to lock down. There's going to be, you know, tens of millions of deaths since blah, blah, blah. Like, he basically completely nailed it.
Wow.
So experts knew this was going to happen.
Sure.
They didn't know the details, but they knew something like this was probably going to happen.
And that's climate versus
climate
weather.
That's climate versus weather. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly what's happening.
Right.
We may not know when Antarctica is going to fall into the ocean, but we know that it's going to happen at some point. So that's why, like, it's a little bit easier sometimes to predict 200 or 300 years, because certain ways, because like, by then we know all this stuff's going to happen. We're not sure exactly when between now and then it's going to happen, but we're going to be at the other side of some transition, you know, by that point. Like, we know we're going to have artificial intelligence, like general artificial intelligence, in a couple of hundred years. When between now and then we're going to get there, it's a little bit harder to say, but, you know, and then we could say, well, once we do, what's the world going to be like, at least from the point of view of that technology. But of course it's interacting with all the other technologies.
Let's shift gears and talk about your current book that's out. Let's talk about that book. What was the impetus to write that book?
A publisher threw a whole bunch of money at us.
Nice. That's the best reason.
Good.
Genuinely the best reason.
That is motivating.
It was very good motivator. Tremendous motivator.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Money and a deadline and you will accomplish a lot. But I mean, you know, I've written book chapters, obviously write a daily blog. I've been doing a lot of writing. Always had like this idea. I really want to write a book, you know, and you know, lots of ideas about the first two or three books that I would write. But then we were contacted by a publisher, you know, and what they wanted to do is they wanted to write a book to our podcast listeners, right? So, and then we learned this is what publishers are doing now, because, you know, book publishing definitely took a hit with everything digital, but they're finding ways to survive. You know, that's why when you publish a book, it's, you know, a paper book, you know, it's a hard book, it's audio, and it's a digital, you know, format. Yeah. So they're selling it in all three formats. That's part of what they do. But they also realized that they could tap into people who already have a built-in social media audience.
Sure. Yeah.
And that kind of sets a floor for them. They can calculate, okay, how many listeners do you have? You know, they wanted to know all our social media stats. And they plugged in those numbers and they figured out pretty accurately like how many books we would sell, at least at a minimum. And also it's free advertising. They don't have to put any money
any
into
marketing
advertising.
Effort in it. Yeah.
We do all the marketing for them, right? It's like built-in marketing, built-in audience. They wanted it to be named after the podcast, you know, The Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. Like that was not even negotiable. Like that's what we want the name to be. Cause that's, you know, we're like, oh good, we could reach out to a greater audience. Like, yeah, okay, sure. But first and foremost,
hey, settle down, son. We already got this figured out.
Now, and so what they're doing is, and they've done this for a while, but what they're doing is they just publish 100 books and they only expect one to hit. They don't know which one it's going to be, but like one will hit and then they'll put their marketing might behind that one. And the rest, they just want to break even, right?
Wow.
And so that's like they're playing the lottery and they just say, all right, we're going to publish a bunch of books. We know how much of an advance to give based upon this and that. So we'll break even, but one will break out. We'll put our money behind that one. That will make millions, right? That's their strategy. We actually fell kind of in the middle because we exceeded the advance, which is always great. That's why we got a second book, because they're happy with us. But we didn't break out. You know, like we didn't get beyond like an order of magnitude beyond the advance. We just extended it a little bit. So it's good and it's still selling and it's mostly the audio version. The audio version is like 80% of our sales for the book.
That's how people are used to consuming your product. That's how people
exactly.
are.
I mean, it shows you that that's, you know, I think they absolutely knew that. Like, there was no question that they were going to do an audio book. I was going to record it. They want, and that was it. Cause they knew what they were doing. I learned a lot about the industry and everything. So, which is good. I'm glad that they're surviving and this is how they're doing it. You know, they're tapping social media was like presenting a problem for them. So they just use it now and they're surviving that way. Absolutely.
Yeah. Content wise, mm-hmm. let's talk about content wise. Let's talk about the book itself. Why did you put all this together
in the way
you did?
Yeah. So, we wanted to make basically the book of our podcast, right? And we talked about a lot of ideas about how that would exactly look and how it would work. But the core of it was always going to be just a primer on skepticism, critical thinking, scientific literacy, the core knowledge base of skepticism and of our podcast. All the things we refer to, you know, it's like this is essentially a reference book for listening to our show and also a primer for critical thinking and, you know, media savvy and, you know, and scientific literacy. It's a tome, you know, it came out really big, but it's like, we had this conversation with the publisher. They're like, 90 to 100,000 words. We came in at 137. So we were blowing past their limit. We had this conversation, like, you know, do what you got to do. This is your, you know, your magnum opus. This is the book kind of needs to be complete. You know what I mean? Like we can't, like, what are we going to leave out? Let's leave out logical fallacies. Like you can't do it. The book doesn't work. It only works if you cover everything. And they got that. So like, just do whatever you got to do. Make it as long as it has to be in order to be what it is, you know? So that's what we did, and we're all very happy with the result. It is everything we wanted it to be. It's a fun read. It's very personal. You know, we try to carry through the personality of all the people on the podcast, but it's also like it's like a primer for critical thinking and scientific skepticism.
That's exactly how I'm about halfway through it. I've started listening. It's funny because I am listening to it. So yeah. I drive a lot and I'm like, oh, of course I'm going to listen. This is how I consume your product. So this is definitely the way I'm going to go with it. And it does very much feel like that sort of necessary, like 100 level introduction to, you know, the basic rules of logic, the basic rules of critical thinking. Like, get this stuff right and you're doing a fair way along in your epistemological journey. You know, these are good tools to have in your toolbox. So your audience, obviously the audience is your podcast. I mean, that's mm-hmm. from a marketing standpoint, that's your audience, but your audience knows most of this.
We made a specific effort to include stuff in the book that was extra that we've never spoken about on the podcast, where either just a new idea or a new example, or we take stuff we may have referenced on the podcast, but go much deeper. And we asked that, like, every chapter is like, all right, what is in this chapter that you would have never heard listening to our show? And so, yeah, but we knew it was going to be, first of all, it's like, you know, the podcast, you get bits and pieces. Like we might talk about one logical fallacy in an episode or whatever. People say, for years, people are writing to us, I need a place where I can get this all in one place. Like, so I know, like, all the logical fallacies that you talk about, all the cognitive biases, you know, et cetera. So it's more thorough.
Yeah.
It is sort of a narrative that walks you through that. It's not just like it's not a reference book, really. It has like a narrative. It reads like a story. But it also had to have new information that you would not have heard just from listening to the podcast. So that was by design.
I think it's a real boon, to your point. I think it is a real boon to have it all in one place. Yeah. This is, you know, absolutely. As I go through it, it's like, it's important information, but as I was thinking about it, when I was listening to it, I was like, you know, I think I know most of this, but I don't know that I've ever encountered all of it in one place. I've gleaned it from here. I've picked it up from there, a little from Carl Sagan, a little from, you know,
right.
I mean, just 100 different sources to put it all in one place and to have it be well organized, and to have a natural flow it's funny because, like, your show's title suggests this book, mm-hmm. that there should be a guy.
Yeah, right.
That there should be a skeptics guy. Where the hell is that? It took you 15 years to get
that was absolutely. And we toyed with that because, you know, it's based upon the skeptic, the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Yeah. Like, that was the inspiration for the title, which is an actual book in the universe of the Hitchhiker's Guide. And that was one of our ideas. Like, let's make this a book in the world of the Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. But it was like too clever and to execute, you know what I mean? So,
right. Until you got a great big check in front of you. And then all of a sudden, we all get a little more clever when you get a check and a deadline.
right. Absolutely. But you know what I mean? It's like, it was just, there was lots of ways to, like, have different layers mm-hmm. of story being told in the book. And, you know, that was one that we had, which we didn't execute specifically, you know, making it, you know, we did keep elements of that. Mm-hmm. So, like, the chapter headers and the way it's organized, it kind of was supposed to be like the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy book in the universe itself, like, pretends that this book exists, you know? So it's funny that you mentioned that, because that was actually one of the ideas that we had. But the other layer that we tried to put in there was, so a lot of these things that we talk about are not static. Like, these are ongoing research, you know, paradigms by psychologists, et cetera. So when there's all these ideas that, we all read, you know, The Demon Haunted World by Carl Sagan, and it was fantastic. It's still a great read. I still recommend it as a good entry into scientific skepticism, but it is dated.
It is. Yeah,
he talks about things that are just no longer considered to be true when it comes to, like, the way we consume information and the way, you know, the best way to address certain issues and how conspiracy theories work, whatever. It's just, it's 30 years old. So part of it, this book is partly an updated version of A Demon-Haunted World. You know, it's like, let's, what has the literature shown in the last 30 years, you know, to inform this project that we're doing? Like, the Dunning-Kruger effect didn't exist, you know, when Sagan wrote his book. So part of it was an update, and it's like,
that's
one of those
funny
things
to think about.
Yeah, even more so for the current book, but it's like, there's constantly studies coming out like, ooh, I got to update that chapter to reference this new thing, which adds a new layer or nuance to this topic. And at some point, like, the editor had to cut us off. It's like, no more updates. That's it. It's done. You can't keep sending us updates because you got to lock in the text at some point. But we're still collecting these studies. And so there's probably going to be a second edition at some point when 10, 15 years go by. There's going to be 15 years of research that we got to update the book with. Yeah. Right. And the future one, forget about it. Like, every week, they're like, oh shit, this is going to, you know.
It's the future again today.
Our book is like slowly becoming obsolete even before it gets published.
We recently, so on our show, we recently, as a book club, sort of did a week after week, read a chapter of Sagan's Demon-Haunted World, and we went through it. And you're absolutely right. It's super dated. And some of the things that he's talking about, it's funny when he talks about how he's sort of appalled at the 10-second attention span people have. And then I started thinking about like TikTok and how quickly you could just scroll through a TikTok page and how quickly your eyes can just capture all this information. I think when we read it, we tried to be very forgiving about like him not understanding the future, being able to predict it, but also seeing if there's some way what he said still could match maybe our current technology. And there's some places it just doesn't work, but in other places that, you know, you can sort of see he knew what was coming. And, you know, there's a quote that's actually being passed around very recently about the foreboding in America. I don't know if you remember this quote, but there's a quote from the book where he talks, I feel a foreboding in America. And it's like, you know, maybe about a paragraph long, and several people have quoted it recently. And you know, a lot of people say he nailed it. He nailed it so many years ago.
We just read a quote from a book from 1939. By a scientist, again, a popular science book from 1939. And the author described, you know, society at the time and the challenges they were facing. And it could have been written yesterday. It was like a perfect description of our current political social climate. So in a way, you know, it's kind of reassuring, you know, because the world survived. I mean, had to fight a world war, you know, so we may have some bad stuff coming our way. But, you know, so I think when you're talking about human nature, whether it's 1939 or 1991 or whatever Demon-Haunted World came out, or today, there's some universal, you know, truths that just, well, and things go through cycles, you know, so they're always going to be true. But there's just so much new stuff. And think about when Sagan was writing, I mean, like the anti-vaccine movement was, you know, not really
prominent
at that time. Yeah. Climate change denial was just a whisper at the time. Like all the science denial stuff really hadn't come to fruition yet. So he, you know, he was talking mostly about what we today would call like Bigfoot skepticism, where it's like all these like, oh, isn't that fun, childish kind of simple issues. Where now we're like wrestling with all these, you know, very weighty anti-science or pseudoscientific issues and issues of misinformation and weaponized misinformation. And just, we're at a whole new level that Sagan may have seen, you know, the antecedents to that. Like he knew that this kind of thing happens, but you know, back in the early 1990s was like nothing compared to what we're facing today.
Talking about
and of course,
aliens.
Social media, like you can't even.
That was some X-Files shit.
We were talking about aliens back then. And a lot of the stuff that he was talking about was about aliens. Do you think, you know, like clearly your book is about thinking critically, scientific skepticism. Do you hope that your book winds, because, you know, you look out at the landscape, the information landscape, there's some, It's a little scary. It's a little scary, especially when you think about how many people believe in QAnon in the United States, how many people believe in, you know, how many people didn't get vaccinated, you know, things like that. Mm-hmm. Do you hope that your book will get into people's hands that might not agree with all everything and maybe change their mind? And do you think that that you wrote it in a way that will be able to do that?
I mean, that was the goal. Like, we're always writing simultaneously to multiple audiences. You know, we're writing to somebody who has no idea what any of this is, and this is their first entry into it, and we don't want to scare them off, you know, but sure. we want to be a sort of a friendly entry into that. We can't pull every punch, right? And so there's still going to be, oh, you dissed acupuncture, I hate you. It's like, okay, well, I have to call it like I see it. I justified it. But, you know, I can't not call pseudoscience pseudoscience, but, you know, we try to like creep up on it, sort of give them the tools to think about it. And, you know, you can't take a belief away from somebody. You have to give them the tools to surrender it voluntarily. Some people will do that. Some people will not do that. So we definitely wanted it to be that, but also we wanted it to be like, if you're already a skeptic, already a listener, you already are pretty much there. This will take you to the next level, right? Yeah. There's enough to do deeper, more information in there for you. And, you know, we occasionally get emails from people who listened to the show or whatever, encountered the book, and they were hostile initially. They were true believers or whatever. Some of them still are and they hate us, but some occasionally will say, you know, that we changed the way they view things. They stopped believing in alternative medicine or whatever, got out of some, you know, pseudoscientific cult or religion that they were in. It happens, you know. So, you know, obviously, what author doesn't want their book to change the world, right? I mean, so we put it out there and hope for the best, you know.
Yeah, I only ask because one of the difficult things, especially, you know, just seeing how things are going in the world, is, you know, how do you change somebody's mind? And I think you kind of touched on it a little bit there by making them sort of surrender to it. Can you expand a little bit on that? Can you talk a little bit about that?
So people do change their mind. We all change our mind all the time, but it's usually a step-by-step process, right? People don't change their mind like the scales fall from their eyes and they suddenly have an epiphany. It's very rare. You know, not that it never happens. Sometimes you do get to this place where you do have a sort of epiphany, and people usually remember those one or two times in their entire life where something just crystallized for them. But that's very rare. Most of the time, our beliefs just sort of slowly morph from one thing to the next. And so that's kind of the, you know, you have to be engaged in that process. So the primary goal of the book is to get the reader, to get people to engage in metacognition, right? We was just thinking about thinking. Because that is kind of a binary thing where there are some people who are just existing in an intellectual realm where they do not think about their own thinking. There's never any introspection, you know, analytical introspection about how they are thinking. And so they're just going with the flow, cognitively speaking wise. And then other people are introspective. They will question how they think about things, how they know things, you know, is their memory accurate, et cetera, et cetera. And so we are trying to get people into that camp, you know, to try to get them to, for, you know, partly by just surprising them with stuff that they, you know, to just show this is how easy it is to fool you. This is how easy you are to fool. That's one piece to it. Once you realize you can be fooled, you realize that you need to have a check in place. You need to have some kind of way of evaluating whether or not you're being fooled, you know? And then once you do that, we then said, then you're there. Now we just got to give you more and more ways in which to do that, more and more tools in which to do that. So one of the things we recommend in the book is to, if when you're trying to help somebody, we're all on this journey, right? No one's there, right? So we're on this journey. We're trying to maybe help other people who are not as far along on this journey. Well, how do you do that? One of the ways to do that is to engage with somebody about a topic that they are skeptical of. Like, tell me something you don't believe. Why don't you believe that?
Oh, that's interesting.
That's interesting.
And you're engaging their own, because we're all, there's got to be something you don't believe in. I mean, if you literally believe in everything, including mutually exclusive belief system, then, you know, you're probably hopeless. But if you can find something they don't believe in, and then just start to basically nurture that. Tell me why you don't believe in that. Oh, because it doesn't make sense. Oh, because there's no evidence. Oh, because, you know, it contradicts this other thing or whatever. Like you just, you start to develop these basic rules of metacognition, of skepticism from there. And they're already invested. And now you're just trying to get them to extend that a little bit to something else that maybe they only haven't thought about, but they don't really have any that you don't go right for their core identity vested interest, right? That's not what you do.
Just rip away the very thing that makes them
your shit. That's you're not.
How do you know if I love my wife anymore? What is happening? Yes, they're just like a crumbled mess, weeping on the floor. I never should have read that damn book.
Yeah, they're just going to cling all the harder. You know, so you just got to take the pathway of least resistance. You know.
You know, I want to say. So you mentioned your book is a tome, and it is. It's a significant, it's a weighty read. Yeah. It takes some time. And I was thinking about when I started listening to it, I was like, oh, it's a longer book. I was just like, oh, cool, it's a longer book. That makes me happy, right? Like, so I enjoy that. But I was thinking, what the heck do we do in a world full of anti-intellectualism?
Yeah.
We have... Your book is this series of sort of intellectual tools, but we are living in a world of anti-intellectual forces that are actively sort of pursuing anti-intellectualism as a new national value.
Yeah.
And how do we bring this tome, or which ideas from that tome, I guess, might be the most important? Yeah. Like if you had to go spark notes, you know, you're going to talk to somebody. Yeah. If I had 15 minutes with Matt Gaetz and Madison Cawthorn and Marjorie Taylor Greene, and I wasn't going to use it to berate them and make them feel small inside. How would I spark notes them? What are the most important pieces?
I mean, we don't have the magic formula, obviously. Like we can't account for how other people, some people are just so locked into their way of thinking. You know, I don't have the magic way of getting them out of it. Again, it's more like you just create the opportunity for it to happen and hope for the best. But the intro chapters, that was exactly the thought process because, you know, you have to capture somebody right from the get-go. And if you don't, if they are not vested in reading that book by the third page, you've lost them.
Yeah.
So, you know, so that was exactly the thought process we had when trying to craft those introductory chapters to the book. And you know, again, the approach is, you know, people are deceiving you. You know, that's sort of my opening line is Spock lied to me. Like Spock as a child, he was an authority figure, you know, almost of mythic quality. And at some point I got old enough to realize that In Search Of was not a documentary, you know, like Leonard Nimoy was hosting this In Search Of program and it wasn't a science show. It was something else. I was deceived. And then, you know, as you get older, you realize that at some point, pretty much everyone has lied to you. Your parents told you a whole bunch of shit that wasn't true. Your teachers told you stuff that wasn't true. Everyone's telling you stuff that isn't true. Why is that? Well, they might believe it, or they may have nefarious purpose. They may be trying to sell you something or whatever. So we kind of need some way to get through this life. We need to have some kind of tools to figure out how to know what's real and what isn't. That's why the subtitle of the book is how to know what's really real in a world increasingly full of fake, right? So that's basically it. So if you get people to want those tools as a self-defense mechanism and also at the same time as an adventure and a journey. So we try to map it out both ways. These tools will protect you from misinformation and fakery, but also will send you on a journey of discovery to cool shit, you know? And so that's always a thing. And Sagan really pioneered that duality of, you know, protecting from pseudoscience, but reveling in the wonder of science at the same time.
Yeah.
And we definitely tried to use that inspiration and model that. But, you know, again, just updating it for a new generation, new world.
When you talk about thinking about the past and looking into the future, you know, when we first started our show over 10 years ago, we even said, I think on one of our first or few episodes, you know, one of the first, maybe within the first 50, we had mentioned, you know, we don't think this show is going to be needed in a few years. We think the world's going to become rational and there's not going to be a need for this show. Did you have the same thought when you first started podcasting? Could you have possibly envisioned a world that we're in now, this world that is really very anti-science?
Yeah, I mean, not surprised at all. But you know, we had been running a local skeptical organization for almost 20 years before, no, I'm sorry, 10 years before we started the podcast. And we had the experience of working with, you know, colleagues who, like, in our organization with us, running a chapter or whatever, who did go into it with that attitude, like, I'm going to change the world, you know? And then they burned themselves out in 2 years. Because if you think that you're going to rapidly alter reality, you know, with your awesome information, and you just tell people what they need to know, and they're going to be like, oh, of course we have to be skeptical, then you're not going to have longevity in this world in doing this. So we knew from early on, this is a generational struggle. We are picking up the torch from those who came before us, and we'll be passing it on at some point, and the world will still be just as crazy as it was. But we just hope, and this is like the one thing that we can't really ever know. It's like, It's a Wonderful Life. What would the world have been like if we weren't here? How much worse would it
right.
be?
Yeah.
You know, we just have to imagine it would have been a hellscape of misinformation if we weren't here. You know, it's like, whatever. It's like, the thing is, we can't know that. So you have to say, all right, well, either I'm going to go down fighting. That's what this is. I'm going to do it, you know, or maybe it's like a little bit of a parachute. We'll make the world not as bad as it would have been if we weren't here. Maybe we might make some actual gains in some narrow areas. And I think we have done that. We'll be a resource for people who want it. Like, I can't force this on anybody. And we take our victories sometimes one person at a time. Like, somebody emails me and says, oh, I had cancer and I was going to give all my money away to this quack, but you convinced me not to. It's like, okay, great. I saved one person, you know, that kind of thing. So you got to take your victories where you can, and you got to enjoy the struggle. You got to really believe in it. But if you think that you're going to change the world, you know, you're going to be disappointed.
Yeah, I don't want to come off as saying, like, we're going to change the world. We thought the world was not going to get crazy, I guess is what I mean to say.
You were naive. I get it.
I was absolutely. Dr. Novella, here's the thing, man. I look back 10 years ago and I think, like, even at the beginning, even this 5-6 years ago, when we first heard a QAnon, I thought it was an absolute, the most funniest thing I'd ever heard. I thought it was a joke. Yeah. I thought it was an absolute joke. And if you were to tell me 5 years ago that 29% of the people in the United States or something,
and members of Congress,
I would be incredulous. I wouldn't believe you. I literally wouldn't believe you.
Yeah. I mean, I have absolutely been surprised over, you know, recent history. Not QAnon, surprisingly, because I think after the flat earthers, you're like, there is basically nothing so stupid lots of people won't believe in it. And
you're right.
You know, the capacity for motivated reasoning is unlimited. It's unlimited. There's nothing so stupid that somebody won't believe in it fervently. So I was already there.
Yeah.
So the idea that there's lots of people who believe in QAnon is like, oh yeah, of course there is. Yeah. You know, especially when you tie it to identity, like political identity or tribalism, like your political tribe.
Right. Yeah.
Absolutely. And we happen to know people in our personal lives who are like this. So it's like, we're there. We completely understand that. What has surprised me is just how fragile our institutions were. I did have this is where I was naive, this naive belief that our institutions were robust enough that they would prevent, you know, anything from seriously happening, you know, like the idea that our democracy would fail because of it was like, no, of course not. Because, you know, at least there are adults, at least a few adults running the country, you know, and there's institutions will prevent abuse and they have absolutely helped, you know, absolutely. We do have robust institutions in this country, but I was shocked at how absolutely quickly and completely, you know, certain political parties just caved to the mob. Like, no shame, no self-respect at all. Like, the utter
no need for internal consistency at all. Yeah.
I mean, I knew that existed in politics, but this is a order of magnitude beyond what I imagined was possible. And now I just have to accept the fact that, yeah, there are just people out there who will completely lie, like shamelessly lie, if they think they can get away with it.
Yeah.
And lie in terrible. The middle of a global catastrophe, lie to the detriment of, you know, tens of millions of human beings' lives. It our institutions held, when you look at some of that, it's like they held because like one or two people held a line.
Right.
And you're like, that's...
Think about how fragile it was.
That is a hair's breadth from disaster.
Yeah.
That's just like one guy who woke up and drank some coffee and took a shit and decided we still had democracy on Wednesday. Yes. And you're like, what? Yeah.
And it's,
what do you mean?
And what's crazy is that happened multiple times. That wasn't just one time. There was multiple times throughout the last 4 years that happened. That was crazy.
But the really scary thing is that now the anti-democratic forces have a roadmap for, so all we need to do,
how to do it.
Is get our people in these key positions and the whole thing collapses.
Yep. Right. Yep. Yeah. Okay. They know where those pinch points were now. Yeah. They get to just disrupt them.
Let's make that happen now.
Yeah. I have one more question.
Yeah, go ahead.
So we talked about this recently on a live stream we did. There's a guy who does this thing that he has a joke conspiracy theory called birds don't exist.
Yeah.
Okay. So he does this thing on 60 Minutes. They did a whole thing on it. It's actually really funny. The guy is very funny. He's a good improv artist. So he's actually clever and funny. What do you think about this sort of troll culture? Is this damaging to our information ecosystem, or is it just good fun? Where do you fall on that birds don't exist thing?
Too.
Because, you know, for us, we walk a fine line. We see some of these very equally absurd conspiracy theories that have pretty much the same weight that are very damaging. Where do you fall on this?
I mean, we've confronted this question for our entire skeptical career, going all the way back to the beginning. It's like, should we do satire? Should we, you know, fake Bigfoot and then say, aha, we faked it, you know, or a UFO or whatever. You know, James Randi had some success doing that. Although
I think
he's
right.
an outlier because he's, you know, he was a fabulous magician and entertainer, and I wouldn't try to replicate that lightly. But I came to believe that I shouldn't do that. I don't have the skill set to pull that off. And also I think that it degrades your trustworthiness, you know? So the thing is, Randy's a magician. He lies and cheats for a living, you know, or, you know, he did. And so it kind of goes along with being a magician and an entertainer. His job is to deceive you for entertainment. My job is to be a reliable expert and an honest broker of information. And so I think it's incompatible with what we do. Like, if you're doing anything that's journalism, that's science communication, people should never be questioning whether you're being for real or not. You know, you always kind of have to be above board. And whenever we do dabble into satire, it's always labeled, this is satire.
Right.
This is satire.
Yeah.
Like, make absolutely no mistake. And then and then you could use it as an art form.
Sure.
But for my organization, for me personally and the people who work with me, no, we will not do hoaxes. We will not do deception. We will not do trolling. We think it's anathema to our, you know, science communication journalism.
Well, a quick follow-up to that, just out of curiosity, just an opinion.
Yeah.
Is satire, do you believe in our current day and age, is satire meaningfully possible anymore?
Yeah, that's the other thing. It's become so hard to do satire. First of all, a lot of the stuff that we're like QAnon, how could you satirize QAnon? It's beyond satire. Yeah. How could you satirize flat eartherism? That's what I would have used to satirize something else. You know?
Right. Yeah.
It's like it's beyond satire. So that's like, it kind of took that away from us because we can't even do it anymore. And because of that, because there are QAnon believers and flat earthers, you can't come up with something so ridiculous that people will automatically know that it's satire.
Yeah.
Right. It won't prove the larger point.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why I get stuck is like, I think of like great satirists of literature, you know, like Swift. And it's like, all right, well, you know, like, let's tell this absurdist tale and the absurdity will highlight these important social issues, you know, like, well, it's all, we're all gonna eat children, you know? And it's like, holy shit, that's Q now.
Yeah.
Like, there's literally Swiftian satire is like, eating, and now we're just there.
Yeah.
So 25 years ago, I wrote a satirical article about alternative engineering, right? And it was a satire on alternative medicine. And I used all the alternative medicine tropes, but applied them to like civil engineering.
Oh, that's amazing.
Like, are you going to drive over that bridge that's floating with magic? You know, you of course not. And then I got contacted by a producer from 2020 who thought it was real.
Oh, I don't even,
And so that's when I'm like, holy shit, I can't do this.
Yeah, no, it's too dangerous.
I thought it was blazingly, this was like, I made it so ridiculous that nobody could possibly believe it. But I was like, okay. So I had to, that's when I came up with, all right, we'll have to put the satire label on it. But I'm like, I just stopped doing it. It's like reality is beyond satire now.
Amazing. Amazing. Dr. Yeah, Novella, if people were going to find your podcast and your book, where would they look?
Just go to theskepticsguide.org. Everything is there.
Excellent.
It's a pleasure to have you on the show again. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you very much.
A lot of fun, guys. Thanks for having me.
So we want to thank our guest today, Dr. Stephen Novella from the Skeptics Guide to the Universe. You can go to theskepticsguide.org, check out all their stuff, and also check out the book and pre-order the new book. Two books. Two full books.
A little showy.
One book now, and then he'll give you the book later if you pre-order it. I mean, you know, why not?
Why you got Skeptics Guide was instrumental to you and I getting into podcasting. Absolutely. And sort of formally getting into skepticism. Great guys and a terrific resource.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're so happy Dr. Novella could join us today. We're happy to talk skepticism with him. Check out their show if you've never done it. I can't believe if you listen to this show, you haven't done it. But if you know, check out that show. Take a look, and we hope you go and purchase those books.
And if you like low production quality, Ian also works for Skeptics Guide.
Yeah, if you like,
so you'll get that same amateur hour feel.
Total, you know, that niche amateur feel that Ian brings to every project he's ever done, that's on their stuff too.
Think about like a sixth grader rushing their way through a diorama.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's kind
like
of
the, like
it.
The thing that you wouldn't hang on your fridge and throw away when they weren't looking. It's like that.
It's exactly it's like that.
So I want to thank Dr.
Why do you bait me every time? Why do you bait me?
I love it. Ian contradicts us with the worst sound quality.
I know. No,
literally
no
known
way to,
me. To
prove our point.
Yeah. From he's calling us from a fucking Edison wax cylinder.
Amazing. All right. So thank you, Dr. Novella, for joining us. And hey, while you're here, like, subscribe, do all that stuff that they do on YouTube, and share these with your friends. Thank you for coming here. Comment. I think that's important on all the stuff. So just comment, write a comment. And any of the jokers that write something stupid, make sure to tell them they wrote something stupid. All right. That's going to wrap it up for this week. We're going to leave you like we always do with the Skeptic's Creed.
Credulity is not a virtue. It's fortune cookie cutter, mommy issue, hypno Babylon bullshit. Couched in scientician, double bubble, toil and trouble, pseudo quasi alternative, acupunctuating, pressurized, stereogram, pyramidal, free energy healing, water downward spiral, brain deadpan, sales pitch, late night info docutainment. Leo, Pisces, cancer cures, detox, reflex, foot massage, death and towers, tarot cards, psychic healing, crystal balls, Bigfoot, Yeti, aliens, churches, mosques, and synagogues, temples, dragons, giant worms, Atlantis, dolphins, truthers, birthers, witches, wizards, vaccine nuts, shaman healers, evangelists, conspiracy, doublespeak, stigmata, nonsense. Expose your sides. Thrust your hands, bloody, evidential, conclusive. Doubt even this.
The opinions and information provided on this podcast are intended for entertainment purposes only. All opinions are solely that of Glory Hole Studios, LLC. Cognitive Dissonance makes no representations as to accuracy, completeness, currentness, suitability, or validity of any information, and will not be liable for any errors, damages, or butthurt arising from consumption. All information is provided on an as-is basis. No refunds. produced in association with the local Dairy Council and viewers like you.